Rick Hale, how are you? We are here for Mojo Monday. It's our favorite time of the week. We are in the middle of a series on Atomic Habits by James Clear, and it's a really exciting book. I mean, we understand that habits make or break us, right? And you've got an awesome quote that I think just kind of summarizes it up. Why don't you rock us with your quote?
So yeah, straight from the book, and welcome to Mojo Monday. It says, here's the quote, your identity emerges out of your habits. Your identity emerges out of your habits. Every action is a vote for the type of person you wish to become.
Wow.
That's a little heavy, right?
It is. I mean, but break that down. Like, what, your identity? Like, whoa, my habits make me? I mean, I've heard that quote before, but I think identity really speaks to something very powerful. Which is why I think this Atomic Habit is such a big, important topic we're talking about. Break it down.
It really is, and there's two conversations that happens in a person's life. The one that they have on the inside, which is largely subliminal or subconscious, and then there's the outward conversations where we say, do, and you know, we act out a role relative to who we think we are. But realize the subconscious brain doesn't know made up from reality, and the subconscious brain really is the inner self that matters most and the most powerful force that we all possess. And all it has witness to are your habits.
Yeah.
It recognizes trends and patterns, and it tries to reinforce. And the other thing that I pulled from the book is that it also seeks the path of least resistance, the safest. And sometimes that identity that you're after or chasing isn't necessarily the easiest or safest, but it is the most beneficial. And that requires real effort in the form of breaking and re-identifying and attracting better habits.
Absolutely. It makes me think of that consciousness loop. Like, we start out with unconscious incompetence, and then it becomes a conscious incompetence, and then conscious competence, and then at some point in time it becomes unconscious competence, right? And really that's the subconscious that says, hey, at some point in time, if I work on these habits and develop such strong habits, it actually, I become subconscious about them, and it just becomes a part of who I am. And that's where I think that identity word really starts to pick up is, are you a healthy person? Are you a musician? Are you a professional real estate broker? You know, whatever that identity yeah. you're seeking, or that definition becomes, those habits make us that way, right?
Yeah.
And it's really a powerful concept. I think this book is absolutely the right book at the right time right now. And talk to me, like, if I have a desire to change my identity, what I'm hearing inside of this book is I gotta learn how to change a habit. What does changing a habit look like?
Well, step one is you have to identify what you're doing and the outcomes you're getting so that you can decide, like consciously decide that you want to reconstruct your identity. And identity is a fascinating thing. So, and this is, again, not to paraphrase or miss the point, to change a habit, first identify the underlying beliefs that created it.
Yeah.
And we're the product of our experiential life and the product of our relationships. And maybe it's generational habits, if you will, or generational perspective around who you're supposed to be or who you're expected to be based on outside influences and not necessarily that inside voice.
Or even the family you grew up in. They
100%.
Probably created habits that way.
They did, and it's easy. Again,
with
the redundancy of habit.
Yeah.
It's easier to keep a habit than it is to change a habit. The question is, are those habits serving you or disserving you? And that's step one. So since behavior reflects a person's identity, altering a behavior or habit in a lasting way requires making sure the alteration aligns with your identity. You can see the ancient roots of the relationship between identity and habits in the Latin translation of identity, which is nothing less than just repeated beingness. And so the key is daily routines represent an individual's identity precisely because he or she repeats them.
I love it. You know, this reminds me of the series we did a little bit of The Four Agreements by Don Miguel Ruiz.
Like, right.
He reminded us that sometimes who we are today is a product of the community or the family we were born into. And sometimes your identity was given to you, not necessarily developed by you, but if you have that desire to change it, it's exactly what we're talking about here, right?
It is. First is the decision, and then the recognition that it's all about habits that rewire your subconscious perception of who you are, that later actually evolves into who you become.
Absolutely.
And habits, by the way, this is a key point to keep in mind if you're thinking, you know, along the same lines with us and you're on this journey. Habits form based on frequency, not time. It's how often you perform and exhibit those habits, not necessarily the duration of any one experience.
Wow. Perfect. So it's even if I did one push-up a day, I'm creating more of a habit than doing 100 every random 10th day.
Well,
right?
Good luck doing 100 random 10th day.
But, all right, so here's the deal on atomic habits. There's really four big suggestions the author makes around how to move yourself towards these habits, which ultimately we talked changes your identity. Last week, Rick, we talked about making it obvious. You know, having that scorecard, what are your positive habits? What are your negative habits? This thing goes both ways, right? And we talked about habit stacking. You talked about putting that medicine you know you need to take next to your coffee pot or your coffee mug in the morning. So those are stacked, you know. So it helps you find that success in environment versus motivation. Mm-hmm. Really making it invisible was all about making it obvious. Is the first talking point around atomic habits. But today, the second talking point is making it attractive. And really, why don't you set the stage for us on that?
Well, if it's something you absolutely despise, even though it has a positive outcome, you'll just find excuses. You'll find reasons not to do it, not to engage. And so one concept shared in the book is that of aligning a positive habit with a growth opportunity in the new habit. Mm-hmm. And so it's not necessarily a positive habit, but a behavior or an activity that gives you reward that you already embrace and enjoy. And the eternal question is, how can you, it's almost like putting icing on a cake or sugaring up a pill that you don't want to take so that you don't feel.
Well, you do that for dogs. You put the pill in the peanut butter.
Yeah,
right?
You get the benefit without the pain. And how do you eliminate or mitigate the pain enough that you'll embrace it?
Yeah. And, you know, that they call that the temptation bundle, right? Like, if I'm in the middle of watching Game of Thrones, which I've already watched, by the way, but if I was in the middle of watching Game of Thrones, I might have a temptation that I watch the next episode once a night, you know, once every night of the week or whatever. So if I have that temptation and then I say, well, I'm going to ride the Peloton or the treadmill while I'm watching my Game of Thrones episode, I'm bundling that temptation that I know I'm going to go home and watch that episode with something that I really want to create the habit around, and putting those together causes me to find success. And to the book's point, it makes it attractive. I get to ride the Peloton while I'm watching that Game of Thrones episode, right?
Yeah. And exercise is an easy area to sort of play this card and to visualize it. And for me, I like mountain biking, I like wakeboarding and snowboarding. And the good news is those are exercise beneficial. Like, it's good for cardio, it's good for muscle development. It's holistic, whole body. I would say that my trainer would argue that it's not, you know, as specific and detailed as, you know, going into the gym where they have 12 exercises to hit every aspect. But at the end of the day, the reward for doing something I enjoy like mountain biking is that I also benefited from the health experience.
Yeah. You know, speaking of the reward, you know, the book talks about making it attractive. You really got to understand this concept around dopamine. And dopamine is really that chemical inside your body that when you get excited, or it just reminds your brain, hey, I like this. And once again, just like in all habits, there's a positive and negative. So if you're in a negative habit scenario, that dopamine's helping you relive that negative habit. But you can use it in a positive sense too. And understanding that dopamine really helps you stay attractive to the habits that change your life. We talked about your son earlier. Like, he is a very physically fit, consciously in shape, individual. So when somebody's trying to create a habit, they say they want to work out, you know, they don't have dopamine around going to the gym in the beginning. Mm-hmm. They got to figure out a way to trick their brain into going to the gym. But at some point in time, like your son today, what happens if he doesn't work out?
I mean, he feels empty. He's almost, depressed isn't the right word, but it's a problem for him if he doesn't go to the gym, not an opportunity to go to the gym.
Yeah.
And man, that's obviously reinforced over time, and that habit became his identity of being a model for health.
Yeah.
And so in some cases, there's the positive side to this dopamine, and the negative, as you mentioned, the negative might be, you know, that I can't wait to have a glass or a few of wine or chips and dip. And
it's so, walking into the pantry and seeing the Doritos bag and that dopamine spikes. And then, by the way, dopamine happens before the event actually happens. You don't get the dopamine from sitting on the couch eating Doritos and then you're sitting there miserable going, that's not the dopamine. The dopamine's what tells your brain, ooh, Doritos. Or in Luke's case, in a positive sense, ooh, I'm missing my workout. I'm excited to go to the gym and feel the benefits of the workout, right?
Yeah, and you have to benefit from the experience of the positive outcome to the extent that it's easy to replace that behavior with a negative one.
Yeah.
And that just, it's not easy.
No. Well, I think the summary of this is you have to learn how to reprogram your brain. And when you're changing habits, you're reprogramming your brain. Now there's physiology, which is the dopamine, that helps you in this process. But then you got to learn to be smarter than your own temptations, or use your good temptations to bundle, to move those habits where you want to go. Because a lot of times you don't enjoy it in the short run. Otherwise, it would have been a habit to begin with, right? Like, we're having to figure out how to create these things in our life, whether it's a lead generation in real estate business or working out to be healthy or eating healthier. All those things that you know you need to want to institute into your life, we're really learning how to use this to reprogram our brains to move forward.
Yeah.
The last talking point, Rick, is really the group influence, right? Whew. Group influence helps make it attractive. It's social. It's accountable. If your community... if you put yourself in a community of healthy living or a community of success in your industry, they're going to already be in the habits of doing the habits that create that success, right? What would you add?
Well, I mean, stacking, you know, earlier we talked about it being like mountain biking and exercise or riding your treadmill, watching your favorite show. But bringing people to the equation is also a version of habit stacking. And to your point,
It
does two things. One, you get the powerful benefit of being around someone who has a similar goal, who's willing to fight the good fight and suffer through it to the extent that at the end of it, you feel the reward. And Absolutely. Also, hopefully, the compelling need or desire, really, to do it again.
Yep.
And so people, I mean, it's accountability, it's also camaraderie, and it's also, there's a huge reward in winning as a team. So, you know, take a deep breath and maybe examine who you're aligned with relative to these new habits that are going to lead to your new identity.
Who's your tribe, right?
Who's your tribe?
All right, so here's a challenge this week. Temptation bundling. Like I said, Game of Thrones episode, ride the Peloton. What's the temptation bundle in your life that you know, hey, I'm going to do this because I'm tempted to go do this activity? How do you bundle it with something you want to create as a great habit to live, make you move towards a really, really big life? What would you add?
I would add, after you determine that, you know, this is the bundle that makes sense to me and inspires me to go do it, remind yourself that frequency is the key. That means it's got to show up in your day planner or it won't exist in your world. You'll find something to replace, distract, you'll end up somewhere else and not perform at the level you could and not develop that frequency that leads to a real revised habit.
There you go. Mojo Monday, Rick Hale.
Mojo Monday, my man. In person, live.
There you go.